Zahvaljujem kolegi Kržanu. Nastavlja odmah dalje. Kolega Crvan.
Hvala. Ja ću danas pričati na engleskom, jer ne znam baš dobro pričati hrvatsko. So I'll just skip to English. I'll be talking basically about the history of transition in Slovenia. I'll focus basically on three periods briefly, first of them being the immediate period after Slovenia gained independence, so the early 90s, and then I'll be focusing some on the process of accession of Slovenia to the European Union and the Eurozone, and then I'll finish with some brief comments on the current economic crisis. So if we start now in the early 1990s, so as we know, in the spring of 1990, Yugoslavia basically ceased to exist as an integrated economy. Basically, the federal state became incapable of collecting taxes, and it basically completely lost its control over the money supply. So in this context, for some, gaining independence almost seemed like a better alternative for the Slovenian economy. But the political and economic situation in Slovenia after it gained independence was far from prosperous, because key macroeconomic problems were seen in a rapid decline in economic growth, which in 1991 basically became negative. It fell for around 15%, and this collapse of GDP was facilitated by the fallout of domestic demand as well as of foreign demand, of course, due to the disintegration of the Yugoslav market. And the situation was also severely worsened by hyperinflation. We know that in 1989 in Yugoslavia, inflation was, 1,300%, I think. And yet in 1992 in Slovenia, the general annual rise of prices was around 200%. So in order to tackle this sharp rise in prices, Slovenian government at first adopted a rather restrictive fiscal policy, which consists of a constrained balanced budget, and this restrictive fiscal policy was also complemented with a restrictive kind of a deflationary monetary policy, which was led by the Slovenian Central Bank. So results of this severe recession and also deflationary policies of the government and the central bank were manifested in large rise in unemployment. So in 1993 and 1994, unemployment rose to more than 9%. Of course, this percentage seems small today, when you know that in Greece and in Spain, unemployment rate is like 25%, or in Macedonia and Bosnia, is more than 30%, but nevertheless, this 9% unemployment was a great shock for the Slovenian working class, because through the whole period of 70s and the 90s, in Slovenia, unemployment never exceeded 2%, so this was kind of a shock at that time. And also from 1990 to 1993, real wages fell for a whole of 25%, so. But despite the worsening conditions on the labor force market and generally worsening social conditions, the Slovenian working class, at least at first, was not able to articulate its interests through effective political or trade unionist action. This was the case especially in the 1990s and in 1991, basically, when the whole of political and public discourse was occupied by the national question, leading many workers to adopt a somewhat reactionary nationalist agendas. But nevertheless, the deterioration of the social and economic situation led to pretty massive strikes in 1992, especially in the heavy industry. So these strikes were, at least in quantitative terms, so considering the number of workers actively involved, the largest strikes in the history of Slovenia. But parallel to this intensification of class struggle, a debate on the future path of economic development evolved amongst the political and economic elites in Slovenia. So the directives they received from the IMF, from the World Bank, were put forth in a kind of a standardized form. Their objective was, of course, to enforce a swift transition in the form of shock therapy by means of privatization of public assets, deregulation of capital flows, and reduction of welfare spending, liberalization of the labor market, and so on. You know the story. The consequences of such policies, of course, in the post-socialist countries that somewhat consistently adopted the recipes of the shock therapy are well known, for example, in Eastern Germany or in Baltic states. These kind of economic policies resulted in a drastic increase in unemployment, which in some cases exceeded 20%, the collapse of welfare state and generally poor economic performance. So between 1990s and 1992, between the Slovenian political elites, basically two fractions were formed. So first fraction was backed by the army of so-called foreign expert advisors, such as Jeffrey Sachs and David Lipton. They were promoting the shock therapy, of course, while the second fraction supported a gradual process of transition consisting of more decentralized privatization and a more flexible fiscal as well as monetary policy that would also target growth and employment instead of being exclusively focused on curtailing inflation. The outcome was kind of a compromise between the two fractions that led to somewhat gradual process of transition to a capitalist market economy in Slovenia. So this is one of the main reasons why the process of transition in Slovenia was not as severe as in the majority of other post-socialist states. Even though the process of privatization and liberalization were on their way, they were not as swift as in other post-socialist countries. And most importantly, the social conditions of the working class did not deteriorate as fast, because most of the welfare state mechanisms, such as public education, healthcare, and pension system, were retained in the 90s. Now, basically, most of the commentators that were in favor of gradual process of transition tend to explain this rejection of the shock therapy by emphasizing only the rationality of the elites that were supposedly smart enough not to blindly listen to Jeffrey Sachs, but read some Keynes instead, I don't know. But this kind of narratives tend to neglect the fact that decisions for a gradualist strategy were also made in the wake of mass worker strikes that erupted in 1992. So as I already mentioned, these strikes were the vastest in the history of Slovenia. It's also worth mentioning that Slovenian trade unions were in the early 90s one of the most powerful in Europe. So the fear among Slovenian political and economic elites towards adopting a shock therapy can therefore basically also be understood as a fear of escalating social unrest and the fear of facilitating class revolt. And this was also basically the context in which the law on privatization was adopted in 1992. So as opposed to the majority of such laws in post-socialist republics, the law on privatization in Slovenia was based on heavy restrictions of foreign direct investments, and it emphasized basically domestic buyouts instead. So these regulations basically prevented rapid acquisitions of Slovenian enterprises by foreign multinational corporations, and also facilitated economic growth based on domestic resources. So at that time, the ownership of companies was distributed amongst state-owned sovereign funds that received around 40% of the shares, while the workers received around 20% of the shares. The rest was distributed among all the citizens in the form of so-called certificates that could later be converted to shares of companies or to mutual funds and stuff like that. So the fact that workers gained considerable amount of shares and therefore became even formal co-owners of the companies at that time seemed like a gracious democratic act. But the sole fact that this kind of shareholder democracy was promoted by Margaret Thatcher in the 80s and by Jeffrey Sachs in the 90s should make us a bit suspicious. So Miroslav Stanojević, who is a Slovenian sociologist, pointed out that it was basically not a coincidence that especially workers in the sector of heavy industry that proved to be the most rebellious in the strikes of the 1992 gained considerable amount of company shares. In some cases, they even became majority owners. So the catch was that the means by which they received the company shares were also the means by which they were pacified. So, I don't know, Augusto Pinochet once stated in 1987 in one of his speeches that Chile is not the country of proletarians, but the country of proprietors. So basically the Slovenian political elite implicitly said something similar, which is Slovenians are not proletarians, but shareholders. So, but these illusions of the shareholder democracy quickly withered away when the workers owned certificates that were converted into, I don't know, investment funds proved to be but a worthless paper, while the managerial elites that were able to convert these certificates into large blocks of shares of big corporations such as Petrol or Krka were awarded with growing yields. At the same time, as Branko Bejnović pointed out, the working class was basically induced to sell their shares in order to maintain a sufficient level of consumption, which meant that through the 90s the shares of the workers plummeted while the ownership was concentrating in the hands of managerial elites and the newly born class of rentiers. However, after 1993 and 1994, a relatively steady period of modest economic growth and secular fall in the unemployment rate followed in Slovenia, wages gradually and modestly rose in real terms due to the end of the recessionary period and due to the fact that trade unions were able to halter the reforms towards liberalization and flexibilization of the labor market. So this gradual model of transition neutralized the most severe social effects of the shift to the market economy and also prevented the rapid process of deindustrialization. So, as was already pointed out by Joachim Baker yesterday, in Slovenia as well as in the Visegrad countries, this industry, basically export industry, was a major pillar of accumulation. And at the same time, as was also already mentioned, the monetary policy that was adopted by the Slovenian Central Bank was not as orthodox as in most of the other post-socialist countries. The central bank basically refused to follow the directives of the IMF that advocated strict policies of inflation targeting and the adoption of a fixed exchange rate regime in Slovenia. So throughout the 90s, the Central Bank of Slovenia allowed a bit higher rate of inflation for the sake of boosting growth and employment. And also a flexible exchange rate regime was adopted. So this rendered possible for Slovenia to some extent to avoid the policies of real devaluation as a means of responding to the international competitiveness or to the negative trade balance and stuff like that. So this basically meant that it was able to avoid policies of direct wage reduction as an instrument of boosting competitiveness. So as opposed to the majority of the post-socialist countries that adopted a fixed exchange rate regime, so Bulgaria, for example, that adopted currency board, Slovenia was able to depreciate its exchange rate and thereby help its industry. But nevertheless, still how the strategy of exchange rate devaluation or depreciation should not necessarily be seen as somewhat more progressive or worker-friendly strategy in comparison to internal devaluation, because the results of devaluation is also likely to be an increase in the rate of inflation, and hence unless workers respond effectively, a cut in real wages. Okay, so now I'll focus a bit on the accession of Slovenia to the EU and the Eurozone. So after the year 2000, basically the most crucial economic reforms were introduced in the context of Slovenia's accession to the EU and the Eurozone. So basically already before it obtained the membership of the EU, in the early 2000s, Slovenia shifted from its more gradual reformist strategy towards a bit more radical, we could say neoliberal policy agenda, but still it was not as harsh as in many other countries. So it went a process of further privatization that was seen especially in the telecommunications, in the public utility sector, as well as in the banking banking industry. But privatization in those sectors was constantly, of course, promoted by the European Commission and the European Central Bank. But nevertheless, it has to be pointed out that the privatization of the banking industry in Slovenia was very sluggish, so Slovenia didn't share the fate of Slovakia and Czech Republic, where basically all the state-owned shares in the banks were sold to mainly Western banks. So, while three of the largest commercial banks in Slovenia still remain state-owned, and I think around 55% of the banking sector in Slovenia is still under state's control. So, but milder deregulations of capital market were introduced, so also reforms intended to attract foreign direct investments were adopted, and flexibilization of the labor market was facilitated. So all of these reforms were accelerated by the process of accession of Slovenia to the EU and to the Eurozone. The accession to the EU and to the Euro was basically already in its beginning conditioned by the adoption of monetary and fiscal policies that were prescribed by the Maastricht criteria, that are basically based on very orthodox notions of fiscal restraint, anti-inflationism, and balanced budgets. So in accordance with those criteria, Slovenia underwent a shift in monetary policy away from policies of boosting employment and towards the policies of inflation targeting. So this also, the deflationary framework of the Eurozone, in addition to the generally poor conditions for productive investment in the whole of the European Union, kind of deteriorated the conditions for the adoption of any kind of growth model that would not be based on the accumulation of foreign debt. So at the same time, the high level of openness made Slovenia extremely sensitive to economic conditions in its main trading partners, mostly Germany, Austria, and Italy, and of course to changes in its international price competitiveness. And during the period Slovenia was in the EU, it gradually worsened its trade balance. But the problem, of course, was that due to the fact that the adoption of the euro prevented the possibility of exchange rate adjustments, Slovenia couldn't respond to a fall in competitiveness as it did in the 90s, so with exchange rate devaluation. But the only policy option for Slovenia in the framework of the Eurozone basically was to cut the costs of production by repressing wages and increasing the rate of exploitation, therefore. So this meant basically that the costs of the adjustments to the new European environment were paid exclusively by the working class that was faced with increasing exploitation, deterioration of the working conditions, and precarity of employment. On the other hand, basically, the integration of Slovenia to the European markets after 2004 provided a very pleasant and stimulative environment for the Slovenian commercial banks, at least until the 2009 recession, namely due to the low interest rate policy of the European Central Banks. The interest rates through the European Union, especially throughout the Eurozone, had fallen significantly, which meant that Slovenian banks also gained access to large amounts of cheap credit from abroad. The costs of public debt refinancing also fell substantially, but of course the Slovenian state was not the one who stood behind the accumulation of debt that accelerated, especially after 2004, as Marko already mentioned. So, but now, after the crisis erupted, majority of the mainstream media and a lot of mainstream economists blamed the excessive public spending and especially the always too generous welfare state and always too vast public sector. This kind of diagnosis is basically simply wrong. While its function is primarily to legitimize the attacks on the working class in the form of austerity measures, so if you look at the data from Bank of Slovenia, you can clearly see that over the last decade, level of Slovenian public debt was very low. So in the period from 2000 to 2008, it never exceeded 30% of GDP. The public debt was actually shrank from 28% in 2002 to 22% in the middle of the 2008. But in 2009, when Slovenia was faced with a very sharp recession, the public deficits began to escalate and the public debt started to soar. So a major share of the soaring public debt can be contributed to the sharp decline in the massive tax revenues collected by the government. So this decline of taxes was itself a logical outcome of a major economic slump in 2009, when Slovenian economic growth plummeted to minus 7.8%. And so the public debt also increased due to the state interventions in the banking sector. So the commercial banks in Slovenia had, as was also already mentioned by Marko, relied excessively on foreign credits in the boom period. But when the global crisis broke out in 2008, the credit lines were interrupted, which caused the major liquidity problems for Slovenian banks. And the state consequently jumped in by increasing the borrowing from abroad and then using the foreign credit to lay it down to the commercial banks in the form of deposits. So these were the main reasons for the rise in public indebtedness, which soared from 22% in 2008 to 48% of GDP in 2012. But this growth of public debt can therefore be seen as a consequence rather than a cause of the crisis. Nevertheless, the public debt of Slovenia is still rather small. It might rise a bit in the near future due to the current plan to establish a bad bank, basically, it was already mentioned. So, basically, a financial institution that would hold non-performing assets owned by a state-guaranteed bank. So, the plan is basically that, yes, all the bad loans would be transferred from balance sheets of the commercial banks to the state-owned bad bank, and the objective of this plan is, of course, to socialize the losses, and it might also lead to an additional rise in public debt. But so the problems basically that Slovenia is now facing the results of the bad conditions basically in the private sector, of the bad performance of Slovenian enterprises and of large levels of indebtedness of the private sector. And basically private sector is also the sector we should focus on in order to comprehend the causes of the current crisis. The most problematic in the private sector of Slovenia are the banking industry and the sector of enterprises. This household sector is basically not a big of an issue, namely the level of household indebtedness in Slovenia was also considerably low throughout the whole last decade. So the household debt to GDP ratio in 2010 was around 30%, so this is exceptionally low. I mean, in European Union only Slovakia has a smaller share of household indebtedness. However, Slovenian enterprises are one of the most indebted in the Eurozone. So large amounts of accumulated debt of the enterprises can be basically explained by their pre-crisis activities. So I'll just go quickly through that because Marko already talked about this boom in 2004. So namely, Slovenia faced a rather massive construction and real estate bubble after the year 2004, especially the construction sector grew at an unprecedented rate, but this growth was mostly credit-based. So in this period, as we've already mentioned, Slovenian banks gained access to large amounts of cheap credit from abroad, and this debt was basically then used mostly to finance domestic enterprises and thereby boost construction and real estate bubble. In the last 3 years, for example, before the crisis, basically the rate of bank credits to domestic enterprises rose to around 25% annually. So this credit growth rate was three times bigger than was the nominal GDP growth rate. So this construction and real estate boom was clearly a credit bubble that eventually bursted in 2008, while banks were confronted, of course, with huge amounts of bad debts and bad mortgages on their balance sheets. The bill, however, is about to be presented to the people. And meanwhile, the banks are getting subsidized by public money, and the working class is getting screwed, basically. Unemployment is rising vastly, so registered unemployment is rose to around 20% in 2012. The wages in real terms are falling in private as well as in the public sector. And, of course, hard budget cuts are being introduced in almost all of the spheres of the public sector, and welfare spending is being reduced. So the current right-wing government that explicitly says that Estonia and Latvia are the countries we should look up to are also trying to introduce a pension reform basically designed to extend the retirement age, and labor market reform with an objective of the flexibilization of the labor market. So, you know, collective, organized revolt by the workers, by the students, and the trade unions is basically needed more than ever.
Evo, zahvaljujem Saši i otvaram diskusiju, naravno. Pitanja.
For me, Slovenia and Slovakia, I mean, there are some interesting parallels and differences, and I would like to make a short comment on that. I mean, both countries, small countries, and both of them being part of a former bigger state. So Slovenia was the richest part of Yugoslavia, and Slovakia the best industrialized and poor part. I mean, in the case of Slovakia in the early 1990s, in 1989, 1990, what is hardly known, workers expressed a lot of sympathy in their leaflets, etc., in the smaller towns for socialismus, ludzke, tvaro, socialism with a human face. It is for the 1960s. And in the companies, there were a lot of conflicts. There were not strike waves like in Slovenia, but something was happening as well. But strong trade unions did not form. I mean, that is a key difference of the two countries. And so far, I would actually confirm your thesis how important these strikes and the strength of the trade unions is. And the Slovakian government, major government, I mean, was in conflict with the central government on the question of preserving industrial structures in Slovakia. Deindustrialization of Slovakia was stronger than the Czech Republic. And they made, in a way, some concessions to workers as well. Accessible public services, for example, that was guaranteed during the major years. Sort of conservative social policies, early retirement, etc. What did not happen, and I think that is the second difference, there was not a rather systematic pro-industrial policy like in Slovenia. And so far, I think this stronger conceptual clearness and this, let's say, a bit more social democratic part of the establishment makes a certain difference with Slovakia. Something like that was lacking. So far, I would say that this makes a difference in, let's say, the ruling circles as well, from my point. Then the second phase you mentioned is the EU accession. And I mean, at the beginning of the accession debate, the major government was voted out of office. And the EU membership issue that was the main election slogan of the right-wing coalition, which included the so-called Social Democrat Party at that time. And in the case of Slovakia, the neoliberal coalition used the leverage in order to impose very radical neoliberal reforms, what did not happen in Slovenia. It was much more gradual, as you emphasized. And now I think what happened in what would be my thesis, what happened in Slovakia during the accession period is now, will possibly happen now in Slovenia. I mean that the crisis is used in order to bolster the right-wing government with outside forces, in that case directly the European Union and alliance of the European Commission, and as an instrument the European stabilization mechanism, pushing through certain so-called reforms which the Janša government would like to do anyway, but lacks the internal force to do so. And I would say that would probably happen in a more cohesive way than in Slovakia, because they had the promise of prosperity and EU, and I mean in the Slovenian case, it's quite obvious, I mean that there will be no prosperity, it will be austerity. And so far, I would say a much more impressive, coercive way of pushing through these neoliberal agenda. And possibly certain division of labor will emerge as it was in Slovakia, that is the banks for the foreign capital and the privatization of certain social services for the domestic financial groups, because that's what they can afford to participate in. So that would be a way of my comparison.
Just one rhetorical question, namely, is state ownership of banks in capitalism necessarily the same as state ownership of banks in socialism? So we shouldn't be too blindly trustful of this expression state owned. Who profits? Who benefits? What's that?
I didn't quite hear the second part of the question.
State ownership, namely this blind trust in state ownership, but of course state ownership, which is a function different from capitalism, namely the rhetorical question is state ownership in capitalism the same as state ownership in socialism? So perhaps it should be not be trustful of this idea of state ownership in capitalism, so we have to understand who benefits.
Well, maybe you'll be able to better answer this question or a comment. I mean, okay, you said it's a rhetorical, but still, I feel interpolated. I'm a pragmatical socialist, so it is easier for the working people to take over the state power. And of course, state ownership doesn't solve much on its own, but still, it is an instrument that can be used, and it can be used in the interest of the broader population, and it, to a certain extent, it was, I think, consciously or not. Or, of course, everything can then, or this central sector can be left to foreign capital. And then what happens is that even if the working people take over the state power, they still do not have power over this system. So basically, I think still from the point of view of pragmatical socialism, it is still better to have an intact state apparatus that can be taken over in a perspective and then socialized, democratized, and so on, than to, you know, leave it to some external, much stronger force, physically, militarily, financially, much, and economically, but much stronger force, which means that your struggles are then much more limited, even if you are successful on general elections, even if you are successful in micro level, the basic components are set and you have no space to maneuver. So this is pragmatic socialist.
And I'll just add, I think, I mean, of course, the sole fact of national ownership of banks, I don't know, is not necessarily something great, at least in the framework of capitalist system. Of course, I mean, in the last 3 years, we've witnessed major nationalizations of banks. For example, I don't know, the first TARP package, this troubled asset relief program in the United States, was basically also its objective was also to buy large chunks of shares of big investment banks. So this was basically a semi-nationalization, but nevertheless, it didn't gain any control over the banks, but it just socialized its losses by this, I would call it semi-nationalization. And also, for example, if you look at the cases of developing countries, Mexico or Turkey, and all the banks there were mainly state-owned, but neoliberal reforms were adopted anyway. But as Marco said, of course, we should still insist on, at least to some extent, as a first step on this objective of keeping banks state-owned, because at least, as Marco said, if there's a progressive force that comes to power, it has something to work with. But if the banks are sold, have nothing.
Further comments? Ako nema, onda moguće da je ovo stanka za ručak, a možda i nije.
Nije
dakle. Dakle, ovo nije stanka za ručak, svejedno gotovi smo dakle sa ovom prvom sesijom. Vidimo se u 13.30, odnosno sa akademskom četvrti 13.45. Da, dobro, bili smo široke ruke na prvoj, pa onda evo. Dakle, 13.30, 13.45. Hvala.